Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome back after this short break in conversation with Shaykh Kazi Lutfur Rahman, who is the respected Imam and Khateeb. In fact, one of the Imam and Khateeb of the famously known Mosque, Regent Spark Mosque. Tonight's discussion is on the topic Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wasalam and Muslim. And in the first segment, we've discussed about the importance of prophets, the difference between Nabi and Rasul, and some of the fundamental principles of Muslims such we should adhere to. In this segment, inshallah, we'll be slightly touching upon the aspect of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, his birth, his da'wah, his message, and most importantly the celebration that we'll be seeing in forthcoming days. What should, as Muslim, or how should we engage and deal with it, inshallah? Now, Shaykh, before I move on to the actual main discussion of this segment, you did mention some of the miracles performed by Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, and it was with the with Allah's will. Now, some people may not believe this fact that it could be a miracle. They may say it could be some sort of magic, it should be some sort of other things, but people who would not believe that it is a miracle performed by God, how should we then respond to such questions?
Well, magic is different to the miracle, because miracles performed by the prophets, and they would claim to be prophets, and they would say, we are the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They would say, we are anbiya, we are prophets.
Now, the biggest criticism some may face, people of faith, that in the era of science and technology, do we still believe in these things?
And of course we do believe, and it happened, and the miracles of Quran is live. We find so many facts mentioned in the Noble Quran 1440 years back, and still they're confirmed by the modern technology and modern science. So the miracles of Quran is live. So it's not something very strange. So coming back to the discussion about the noble Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, let's see what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, how he spoke about this great messenger. A hadith mentioned on the authority of Abu Hurairah radiyallahu anhu, that the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasalam said, qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam, ana awla an-nas bi Isa. He says, I am more close to Isa, Jesus. I'm more akin to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Ana awla an-nas bi Isa, meaning I have more rights of him over him, and I'm close to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. And again, don't forget, a prophet from the Arab talking about a prophet in Bani Israel. This is something that we need to take into account. We need to see why he would be speaking like that, unless somebody inspired him to speak, unless the divine power, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inspired and instructed him to speak in that way. So he said, Ana awla an-nas bi Isa, or that Isa alayhi salam er shobteke nikotoborti ami, ebong una shobteke balobashakari ami. And then he said, Al-anbiya'u abna'u allat, walaysa bayni wa bayna Isa nabi. So it says that between me and Prophet Isa, there is no Nabi, and they are people of one, they're of one father, meaning they came from one father. And then in another narration it says that their religions were different. Ummahatuhum shatta, sorry, the ummahatuhum shatta wa deenuhum wahid. In another narration it says their religions were different. So all the prophets that came, the fathers, they had one father, the religions were different, sharia as we mentioned earlier, wa deenuhum wahid, but they had one religion, one aqeedah, that one creed, one faith, which is the oneness and tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, believe in one Allah. That is the most important and exclusive thing in Islam, and this is preached by each and every single messenger. So see, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaking very high of Isa alayhi salam by saying al-anbiya wa ikhwatu li'allat ummahatuhum shatta wa deenuhum wahid, and then he said walaysa bayni wa bayna Isa nabi. And then we see Quran al-Kareem says very clearly in a very beautiful verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says wa idh qalatil malaikatu ya maryamu, behold, when the angel said, behold O Maryam, inna Allah astafaki, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has selected you, وَطَهَّرَكِ and purified you. You know, Maryam alayhi salam, the mother of Isa alayhi salam, she was one of the most righteous women in the history of mankind as far as Islam is concerned. But Islam drishtite un shobtheke kintu ekjon pobitro mohila nari chilen Islam manob jatir itihasher moddhe. So wa idh qalatil malaikatu ya Maryam inna Allah astafaki wa tahharaki, Allah has purified you, made you pure, وَاصْطَفَاكِ عَلَى نِسَاءِ الْعَالَمِينَ, and he chosen you above the whole entire mankind, above the alameen.
What was the reason for that?
You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gave an honor to Maryam. And of course, He prepared her to give birth to a great individual known as Jesus Christ, peace be upon Him, Isa alayhi salam, who would be serving and of course guiding the mankind to the truth.
Now, is there any reason, a particular reason for elevating her status because of her actions, because of her deeds?
Yes. Of course, there are certain individuals in this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored them and respected them because of the way they are. And Allah has chosen them to be like that. Istifa. This is just a gift. It's just not like something you can choose. It's called selection. Istifa means, like when we say Muhammad Mustafa, Mustafa means selected one. Mustafa means selected one. Istafaki ala nisa'il alameen. He gave a status above the women of the world. Maryam alayhi salam. Who is talking? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam. Talking about the mother of Jesus, peace be upon him, Maryam, a Jewish woman at that time. Why would he speak in that way? We need to take that into account. So Quran speaking very highly of Maryam alayhi salam. You know, there is a chapter in the Noble Quran dedicated for Maryam alayhi salam. And that's the chapter Maryam. You cannot even find, according to the scholars of the comparative religion, tulanamuluk dharmer jara scholar unara bolechen je bible er moddhe apni kono ekta chapter paben na je chapter er moddhe maryam name kono chapter, but you can find in the Noble Quran speaking in details about Maryam alayhi salam and her son Isa. Details not only in Surah Maryam but in several places and occasions in the glorious Quran.
Can I get directly proportional? In today's era, how important it is for us as Muslim comparative religion study Quran?
I think it's very, very important in order to do dawah. Because if we need to speak to the others and the people of other faith, and especially
or no faith,
yes, or no dharma alapalochona korte chai, ami mone kori eta khubi guruttopurno amaderke ei bishoye shamanno minimum knowledge thakar amader proyojon.
Correct. Emphasis kintu we don't see much within our society, especially within the Muslim movement. But I do understand as well, or perhaps we do understand, because the people don't even study Islam, let alone any other comparative
exactly.
religion.
Exactly. So it's not like a subject that is actually focused a lot. But I think Islamic universities and Islamic institutions around the world, especially in this country, in the West, should make a separate subject known as or entitled as comparative religion. And alhamdulillah, in Jamiat al-Azhar, in Al-Azhar University, they have faculty of da'wah. And I've seen in faculty of da'wah, they do a lot of comparative religion studies, religious studies.
But one may say, we don't see any ulama that are skilled in comparative religion.
Unfortunately, there are scholars, but they are more probably within the Arab community or within the Arab world. Mm. So there are scholars of comparative religion. I've seen even in Azhar and even Egypt and in the Middle East, you'll find. But most of them speak in Arabic, so therefore they're not quite
fair
known.
Because in the English-speaking world, non-alims
yes,
to be...
Yes. But I think it's important that we educate our children and new generations in comparative religion, so that at least they know the difference between Islam and Christianity and Judaism. Because everybody, you see, everyone's claiming to be the people of truth. And now, in order to understand and verify, we need to know the differences.
And also to understand each other, people of faith and no faith.
Yes,
because
yes.
there needs to be a common ground.
Exactly, yes.
So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, تَعَالَوْا إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةٍ سَوَاءٍ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ.
Yes.
If we take well, that verse,
الكتاب, تعالوا إلى كلمة سواء بيننا وبينكم.
Yes. Now, should that not be then a very important subject for us Muslims to take into
account? Absolutely. And I think, as I said, I would like to request every Islamic institute around the world, especially in the West, to actually initiate a subject, maybe like include a subject as comparative religion. And that will make a lot of things easy for the new generations and also to uphold the faith of Muslim or Islam in this modern time and society. So Quran al-Karim speaks very highly of Maryam alayhi salam. Then we see it gives a name, and then we see also Muslims. We as Muslims, we have the name Maryam probably more than the Christians themselves. How many names do you have Maryam in a Muslim community? You find your sisters, wives, aunties, you find like Muslim names, very common name Maryam. And then also you see like even the like you know names like Dawood, David, Yaqub, Jacob, Yusuf, Joseph. These are Jewish names, Jewish prophets, but we have no inferiority complex as Muslim. Or the Amra A Bishoy kuno mind korina. Amra unara amader prophet, amader nabi. Ejonno amader Muslimander moddhe apnara oshongkho ogonito manusher apni nam paben Yusuf, Yaqub.
I guess the Arabic name Dawood. people would say that's an Arabic name, so that's why
no, but then again these are prophets sent to the Bani Israel.
Okay,
let's not forget that. So you see, we as Muslims, we love and respect these prophets, and therefore we name our children after the names of these prophets, like Dawood, Yaqub, Yusuf, and others. So we need to really take this into account as well. So far, we have these similarities between us and Christianity. There's not much difference in what we said. But there are some differences that we need to mention so that we are clear in certain points, the difference between us and the Christianity, or even the followers of Jesus, Isa alayhi salatu wasalam.
Now, before we move on to this topic, I would like to be just finding out your thoughts, because some people, when they say mention difference, they straight away they think of division.
Yeah.
If you can just clarify before getting
into we're not here to condemn any religion or faith, because my religion teaches me to be respectful to all other faith. You see, Quran is very clear. It says that la ikraha fid din. There's no compulsion in religion. It says also lakum dinukum waliya din, that you know these are all established religion. You have your faith, I have my faith, but yet still we can discuss and dialogue. That's not a problem. Ud'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal maw'izati al hasana, call people to the way of Allah with wisdom and with beautiful speech, and that's fine. But we are not here to speak evil. Amra kuno dharmo kuno kuno akida kuno bishesh kotha kintu amra kharap bolchina. We're not talking bad about them, but we are just clarifying and mentioning from a theological perspective the differences and similarities. So, talking about the differences between Muslims and the followers of Isa alayhi salam, those who claim to be the followers of Jesus, priest be upon him, or Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. Number one, that we do not believe that he was a god. That we do not believe in his divinity. Or that amra bishash korina the Isa alayhi salam uni Allah ba uni kono ilah chilen. We do not believe that he was the begotten son of Allah, that Allah pak rabbul alaminer putro. It amra bishash korina. Wal iyadhu billah. We do not believe in Trinity. Or that Christian dharme bola hoyeche the Father is God, the Son is God, and the Holy Ghost is God. But there are not three gods, but there is one God. We do not believe in the concept of Trinity in the Thaluth that as mentioned in Christianity. We also disagree quite respectfully that he was God incarnate. So we don't believe that Isa alayhi salam came to this world as a God in order to understand the pains and the problems of the people, as is mentioned in all denominations of Christianity. Or the Christian dharma protector sect among group er moddhe bola hoy je Isa alayhis salam uni ei prithibir moddhe eshechilen Allah hoy ortat Allahr putro hishebe bol ayaz billah manusher somoshya gulo bujhar jonno manusher pain gulo bujhar jonno. And so this is the reason why he came as God incarnate. And this theology understanding is taken from the Hindu practice or Hindu faith or Hindu theology, as the scholars of comparative religion mention. So we respectfully disagree that Isa alayhi salam was not a son of Allah. In fact, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he becomes really upset and angry when someone associates any partnership with him. So we see there is a surah in the Noble Quran, a small surah known as Surah Al-Ikhlas. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, he spoke very highly of that surah. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bolechen, surah Ikhlas jodi kono byakti pore taken, tahole one third, ek trityangsho Quran Sharif porar sawab mile.
And is that the definition of ilah?
Al-Ikhlas,
yeah.
Surah Al-Ikhlas, sincerity. But why this surah is so important? If you read three times Surah Al-Ikhlas, you are basically getting the rewards of completing the whole Quran. And the reason why this surah is so important, because it actually contains the theology of Muslims, the aqidah of Muslims. Why? So surah says, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the Christians from Najran delegation came, a delegation from Najran in Saudi Arabia, in the Bilad al-Hijaz, Bilad of course like al-Haramain, the delegation came and they were speaking to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about God. And eventually they asked, what is the concept of God in Islam, in your prophethood or in your risala? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instantly to say, say, O Muhammad, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. Say, Allah is one and only. Allahu samad. Allah is self-sufficient. He is not in need of anybody, and everybody is in need of him. لَمْ يَلِدْ. He never begets, meaning he never give birth to anybody. وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. And he was never begotten. He was never born. So he never gives birth to anybody, and he was never born. وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. And there is nothing like unto him. So this small surah clarifies and gives us a clear understanding of Muslims' theology or aqeedah. So we again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't like, and he also spoke in Surah Maryam when he said, like, لَقَدْ جِئْتُمْ شَيْئًا إِدَّا. They said the most merciful has taken a son. And Allah said, لَقَدْ جِئْتُمْ شَيْئًا إِدَّا. They came with some great mistake and some sort of superstition. Also, we respectfully disagree with our brothers and sisters in Christianity that the Isa alayhi salam, they say, so Isa alayhi salam came to this world in order to understand the pain and problems of people. And at the age of 33, or the 33 বছর বয়সে Isa alayhi salam, উনি কিন্তু crucified হয়ে গিয়েছিল, উনাকে কিন্তু ফাঁসি দেওয়া হয়েছিল ক্রসের মধ্যে রেখে. So he was crucified, and we as Muslims say no, Isa alayhi salam was not crucified. And of course the scholars of comparative religion debated on that, and they proved that he wasn't crucified. Quran al-Karim very clearly speaks about the crucifixion of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. We don't believe he was crucified or killed, rather he was raised by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and he'll come back to the world once again towards the end of the time in order to establish the fairness and justice and harmony and peace, and will fight against the corruption.
Now we're coming towards the end of the program, and just a clarification that required. Many people might get confused, or even there are questions raised, then does it not mean Rasulullah Purat Arakjan Prophet Ashchan Tawleh? Does he not believe after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Isa is coming? So many people will think that when we say that there is no Nabi or Rasul after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then how come Isa is coming back? Isa alaihi wasallam.
So he's not going to come as a prophet. When he gets Nabi Jabashbina, when he Ashbin Ekjan Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he will come as the follower of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not as a prophet again. Okay. This is something we need to be very careful. So Quran very clearly says in Surah An-Nisa, وَقَوْلِهِمْ إِنَّا قَتَلْنَا الْمَسِيحَ عِيسَى بْنَ مَرْيَمَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. When the Jewish people at that time were boasting that they killed Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. They said, we crucified him. Inna qatalna al-Masih Isa ibn Maryam
Rasulullah. According to the Quran.
According to Quran al-Karim, okay. Yes. And then, wama qataluhu, neither they killed nor salabuhu, crucified. Walakin shubbiha lahum. But what happened there? A resemblance of Isa was put over another man. And they thought that they killed Isa, but they actually killed another person. وَلَكِنْ شُبِّهَ لَهُمْ وَإِنَّ الَّذِينَ اخْتَلَفُوا فِيهِ لَفِي شَكٍّ مِّنْ. And those who differ, they're full of doubts. They have a lot of doubts. ওদের মধ্যে কিন্তু অনেক শাক এবং শুবা রয়ে গেছে. مَا لَهُمْ بِهِ مِنْ عِلْمٍ إِلَّا اتِّبَاعَ الظَّنِّ. They have no knowledge of certainty. ওদের কিন্তু knowledge এর মধ্যে কোনো yaqeen নাই. But they just follow the conjecture. They follow the guesswork. So very clearly that, you know, he wasn't crucified or killed. Now, coming to the birth of Isa alayhi salam, was he born in December? Of course, the country is preparing, the whole entire world is preparing for Christmas. So I believe it's a little bit important to touch upon the issue of Christmas.
Yeah, but briefly, before I go into more details of it, again, this is very commercial now.
It's exactly, not, yeah.
There is no religious sentiment as a whole. It's
sure,
more
sure,
now
yes.
driven
yes,
to
yes.
commercial. So
yeah.
If you can slightly touch on how should Muslim respond.
I will do so. So number one, so we're talking about the birth of Isa alayhi salam now. When was he born? So now let's see what the Christians are saying, or the modern Christians are saying. There is a difference of opinions within the modern Christian followers of Christianity. We see in the West, in Britain, in France, across the Western world, the Christmas is celebrated on the 25th of December. Whereas when we look at the Eastern world, like Egypt, Palestine, we see it is celebrated not on 25th of December. Do you know when? Is on the 6th or 7th of January. Mm-hmm. So it's a major difference between the Christians of the West and Christians of the East on the date of the Isa, the birth of Isa alayhi salam, or the milad of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. So there is a difference between a difference amongst the Christian world or the Christianity of this time. Now, Christians of the early time, really, they didn't have much knowledge about the birth of Isa alayhi salam. They didn't know actually when he was born, the Christian of the early time. And we'll see how it is.
Now, one may say it would be unfair for us to make a comment as Muslims.
No, but then again, it's mentioned in the book. So let me just read for you. The New Testament gives no date or year for Jesus' birth. The earliest gospel, St. Mark's, written about 65 CE, begins with the baptism of an adult Jesus. This suggests that earliest Christians lacked interest or knowledge in early Jesus, or the early childhood of Jesus, peace be upon him. So we're not talking from the Islamic perspective. We're also talking from the Christian perspective as well. Now, so this is number one. So there is a difference between 25th and 6th, as I said, in the West and in the East. Now, Quran al-Karim really suggests that Isa alayhi salam was not born in the cold weather. He was born in the hot weather, and actually around the springtime, or just before the summertime. And how do we know this? Now let's look at the Quran al-Karim. So it talks about the birth of Isa al-Islam, Jesus, peace be upon him. In Surah Maryam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَحَمَلَتْهُ فَانْتَبَذَتْ بِهِ مَكَانًا قَصِيًّا. She conceived him and she withdrew him with him to a far distance part of the of Jerusalem. Meaning she went to a place called Bethlehem or Beit Lahem, about four to six kilometers away from Jerusalem. যখন উনি ওইদিক দিয়ে যান, বাইত লাহমের দিকে যান মারিয়াম আলাইহিস সালাম, উনার উনি প্রেগনেন্ট অবস্থায়, তখন চাইল্ড বার্থ শুরু হয়। ইউ নো, শি ওয়াজ অ্যাবাউট টু গিভ বার্থ টু ঈসা আলাইহিস সালাতু ওয়াস সালাম। আল্লাহ সুবহানাহু ওয়া তাআলা হি সেড এন্ড কল্ড আপন মারিয়াম আলাইহিস সালাম সেইং, ডোন্ট গ্রিভ, ডোন্ট বি আপসেট, তুমি দুঃখিত হয় না, তুমি ডোন্ট বি আপসেট, বাট ওয়াট ইউ ডু ইজ দ্য ইউ নো শেক দ্য ডেট পাম, শেক وَهُزِّي إِلَيْكِ بِجِذْعِ النَّخْلَةِ and shake the trunk of date palm towards you, it will let fall fresh ripe. অর্থাৎ খাজুর পড়বে, যদি তুমি খাজুর গাছকে তুমি ধাক্কা দাও এবং এটাকে শেক করো, তো খাজুর কিন্তু পাকা কোন সময় পাকে? When is it ripe? Not in winter, but in the hot weather. No. But also biblical position suggests that Isa alayhi salam wasn't born in summer, but he was in winter, but he was born in the hot weather.
Now time is coming up towards the end. Now we've got very limited time. But now, obviously, I just want to conclude on this note. Now, as Muslims, how do we respond? How do we interact? Because a lot of question comes up as should we celebrate Kismar? Or Muslims should not celebrate Kismar?
Okay. So, first of all, I would like to say, Isa alayhi salam was not born even at that time. As Muslims, we are very clear about that.
I mean, there's a debate
on
that.
Okay. As Muslims, we are confirmed. Okay. But within the Christian world, there's a debate.
Okay.
Because they say it came from paganism. It came from the sun worshippers. Even many Christians say that. So why are we celebrating a day when actually a prophet wasn't even born? Do you understand what I'm saying? If he was born, then we can debate whether we can do mawlid or not. That's another thing. But then he wasn't even born at that time. And that's even a fact within the Christian world. I'm not saying, I even spoke to Christian people and they said that it's not actually confirmed. And they said, many of them say that it came from the paganism. It came from the অর্থাৎ সূর্য যারা worship করত, সূর্য যারা পূজা করত, ওদের কাছ থেকে জিনিসটা এসেছে.
So does,
we have no time to give more details, but there are details about this.
So then should Muslim not direct them to the relevant sources and get the information rather than indulging themselves in a debate
and that's
or discussion?
Right. And again, I say that we as Muslims, actually we have a lot of inferiority complex. Do you ever see like others are coming and actually celebrating Eid? How many people we see, they're actually getting involved very actively to celebrate Eid as with the Muslims. But then we as Muslims, we have a tendency of just going along and we need to be very careful. But then, as you mentioned earlier, it's very commercialized. It's very, and the people who promote the Christmas is business people more than anybody else. And there's no chance for exploitation in business as well.
Okay, Jazakallah khair. I would love to continue the discussion many more. But thank you very much for your valuable nasiha and your valuable sharing us your valuable knowledge. And inshallah, we look forward to see you again in our next episode.
Inshallah, Rabbil Alameen.
With this, my dear viewers, we have come to the conclusion of our tonight's discussion. Before we leave, we would like to leave on this note that the discussion that we had on this program is solely based on the Islamic principle, Islamic Sharia and Islamic Aqidah. In no way we are trying to undermine any faith or any other religion or trying to create any division. It's solely the sole discussion was based on academic purposes. Inshallah, if there is any confusion, if there is any doubt, please do write to us, please do email us, and inshallah we'll try our level best to clarify, or do get in touch with a qualified scholar wherever you are, and inshallah they can clarify this matter more in details. One of the important discussion that we can take from our today's program is we need to live with peace and harmony. We need to educate ourselves and we need to spread the message of truth to our neighbors, to our friends and colleagues. And inshallah, that's when we will be able to acquire more peace in this society. Inshallah, that's all from us for tonight. Till we meet again. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Jazakallah khair, Sheikh.
Thank you very much.